Now I would request Mr. B.I. Ajri, RTO Pune, to share his thoughts.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. we are here to understand vehicle telematics. You all will be here for about 2 days. As you know, we are discussing about a paradigm shift in transport and logistics. The technologies like telematics, be it in vehicles or related to human beings, they have been hugely beneficial. They are hugely disruptive. Maybe 10, 20 years ago, you had a problem of gallbladder and you had to be operated. They would open your stomach and remove it. Now you have a procedure called cholecystectomy because of very good endoscopes, and you are out in the evening. You go in the hospital in the afternoon and you are okay. You have to just rest at your home for a couple of days and you are okay. This is happening to every industry. Technology is the biggest disruptor. Maybe it is the camera industry, or maybe it is the cassette recorders, the audio systems. One mobile and you don't need anything now. We were buying cameras for a lot much of money, the Canons and the Nikons. 5 pixel and 6 megapixel for a lot of money. Now you have a mobile which is 24 megapixels. So that is what is happening to vehicle industry also, because of so much of technology that has come in. And this is only possible because there's an integration of so many things. There's GPS now available to us. The hardware is available to us. And because of this, we have something that is called as ITS, which can be used. We have something like tracking systems, which can be used. As Nandan said, you really need to understand ROI when you apply this technology to your business. And when you find out of 100 vehicles that are transporting goods every day, there are at least 50, 60 vehicles are stranded in some place or other for not being loaded or unloaded. And the cumulative effect of all that is huge. Then there are signal systems in every city where if they are not dynamic, then, you know, the times are fixed. कहीं कहीं 30 seconds से कहीं 2 minute है, तो गाड़ी नहीं रहती है, फिर भी वो आपको रुकना पड़ता है 2 minute. I wonder how many people shut off their engines. You keep on idling and the huge amount of fuel is lost. You have systems where it can be made more dynamic. You can sense the traffic and alter the signals. There are a huge lot of industries. Actually, in a motor vehicle department throughout the country is going through a revolution. There's a new act on the anvil, and you find almost in all the states, all the data is on Vahan and Sarthi. All the registrations are done on V4.0, and the licensing is done on S4.0. So all this data is available for you for doing whatever things you want to do. And so I think this session of telematics, which will be dealing into application of GPS systems, the fencing, QR coding, the OBDs, is really important for all of us, for you and for me. And we are here to understand what exactly is going on in the industry, and how, for example, in a place like Pune, you have lot many schools. They are almost the number is in so many thousands, and we have school buses which amount to about 10,000. Whenever there's some incident about something happening to a girl child or a boy child, and we have problems, so we have been after them to get the systems installed, the GPS, the camera system, so that everybody is comfortable, the parents, the school authorities, the enforcement agencies. You know what exactly is happening to a child. In case there is some evil-minded person who would like to indulge, he would be, you know, careful, because he knows that there's a surveillance system, and I will have a tough time. So all this is being done thanks to you guys, that we have some tools of analysis. Maybe further on, when all these things are clubbed together, for what Nandan said, actually, when there are big operators like VRL or someone else, they can spend money and install systems. Now what you need is actually you need to aggregate all these small operators, the smaller ones, right from the delivery van guys to the hydraulic axle vehicles. If you can aggregate all these things, it is a much cheaper solution. The solution which is offered by Uber is the cheapest one. He's aggregating, he doesn't own anything, but he's aggregating so many vehicles. So if this can be done to passenger vehicles, goods vehicles, I think the huge amount of productivity can be achieved. So all the best to you all guys, the organizers of TI Automotives and all those keynote speakers. Thank you very much. Good luck to you. Right now, I wonder about other areas, meaning goods transport, I wonder. But in case of school buses, it is a must. You know what? In case of school, it is not only the transport department that makes policies. It is education department and transport together. So there one incident took place in Pune regarding a molestation thing. They issued a circular saying that there should be a camera and GPS system where there would be also a control room. It could be either with police or some other authority, and this control room could be like he said, there will be many operators. You have your own choice of using an GPS system provider. There could be many because it is choice of the school. But we said if they talk to each other, meaning the GPS guys, then we have one central control room. This, you know, doubles up for other transport also. For example, we want it in Ola, we want it in Uber, some kind of panic buttons or some kind of indications where if something goes awry, then we can get a signal and things can be taken care of. So as far as passenger transport is concerned, we are keen on it, government is keen on it. But as far as goods transport is concerned, I'm not sure.
Like a couple of years back, there was a drought condition, and probably that area may not be under your purview.
I'm a very small man for that, actually.
That district magistrate level, the entire water movement, or it came under the, it should be a tanker-based operation started in some of the districts, drought condition districts, where the people started, the transporters started counting on the, even the tanker has not gone.
They have started counting the money on that because the government has to pay on that. So they they made a compulsion to the GPS. So there was, the business was cropped up to the GPS suppliers. And GPS suppliers started giving a lot of GPS to this government organization, the tankers which have been supplied by the tanker owners, and the water has been supplied across to that district or the adjoining district, where the business has happened, and the few of the GPS suppliers I am aware of, they are given the fantastic dashboards where the detention is happening, where the water is pulled up, and where the water has been distributed, and set all on the timelines. But again, barish aa gayi, business khatam ho gaya. So it's an initiative which is happening on per instance basis, and probably that may be true from the government point of view. When there is no requirement of the water, when the all is well, and everything is in the well, nothing is required, right?
Actually, there are some areas in goods transport, like, this is PDS, public distribution of services. Like you have a contract for sugar transport, you have a government contract for wheat transport. There you need these kind of systems because, it has to be picked up from some godown and it has to go to the taluka place, the godown, and there you have to distribute. So this comes handy there. That is one area where it can be made mandatory by the district magistrate. Yes. Second is this hazardous vehicles which carry petrol and diesel. I think they have it in place more or less now. I had been to this place in Loni. All those three guys, HP, BP and IBP, all of them have it in place. They also have taken care of the human side because these guys, normally the turnaround time in case of these goods is very important. So they take care of these drivers in case they are held up. They have a retiring room and some kind of TV, a canteen and things like that. So, and it, because they are doing a fabulous job, hazardous goods transport is like carrying a bomb all the time. So you have to be on your toes. So that is another area, like school bus. These are some areas where this becomes very important. And like Nandan said, there are some areas would crop up suddenly because of some problem, because water transport was an essential thing during the scarcity of water, and there were a lot of things happening, people taking disadvantage of these schemes. So this was the best thing to control. Instead of manually keeping registers, this is a technology platform which tells you everything. So that's all about it. I thought I would have no questions at all.
You will be having Matthew. So this is regarding the AIS 140 guidelines which has recently been launched.
Yeah.
Not recent actually.
Yeah.
But so what's happening is it's continuously getting pushed, the date of implementation. And also I think it's a good initiative for all these passenger vehicles to have this kind of a system in place. But what will also be necessary is a good enforcement authority. For example, in my vehicle, there may be a device, but the person who's coming to check, he should know whether it's actually working, not working. And what we've also seen in a lot of cases is when school buses actually, this is in Bangalore, they go for some renewal to the RTO, and just before the renewal, they might add a GPS tracking unit and just get a certificate stating that the vehicle has this particular tracking unit. That's one point. And second thing is, who would be the right authority to really set up this entire infrastructure to regulate this? Because we have actually spoken to a couple of the IT secretary offices of a couple of governments, but nobody seems to have a really concrete plan regarding the enforcement of such a directive. And another point is, when you're looking at implementing something like this, the scale is huge. Millions of devices connected, and each state has to have the necessary infrastructure to support this. So just wanted to know your thoughts on that.
Okay. Now, as you know, the guys who work on AIS are normally the major guys are in Pune, the main people, ARAI, CIRT, there's an ICAT also. So all these guys really work on this along with the Ministry of Surface Transport and Highways. And they come out with all the things that you need for, maybe it's for a sleeper coach or a camper van or some goods vehicle or special purpose vehicles, what should be the standards and how things should be, what should go into a school bus, what kind of system should be there and things like that. It could be bodybuilding, it could be electronics, it could be telematics and things like that. So all this goes into IS. Now coming to its enforcement, the best example is SLDs, the speed limiting devices that we've been putting in the passenger vehicles now. When this came in the first time, there were hardly any limiting devices in the market. One or two people were there, some were Chinese, and there was no backup also. Costs were also phenomenally. Once the GR comes out, I should not be saying a lot of things here, but suddenly you have to go to the market because there's a deadline, and some people know about the deadline. So there are only one or two guys who are supplying the whole thing, and then there are problems. So, and you have no choice because those guys are held up otherwise. Mera taxi hai, agar mera SLD aaj nahi baithta hai, toh mera passing nahi hota hai, uske baad mera dhanda band ho jata hai. So all that kind of thing, you know. As he said, how do you regulate all this? Because there are so many gadgets, there are so many implements inside the buses, and who would be verifying this? Classically, it is going to be the motor vehicle department. The RTOs of different districts would be looking into this. But as we all know, there's huge shortage of manpower. They are all technical officers now. The act mandates that they should be automobile engineers or mechanical engineers. That is a basic qualification. But even with that, the manpower itself is pretty less. For example, in Maharashtra, we do it in a much, much better way now. For example, the annual inspection, which is done every year in case of a goods vehicle, for the new vehicle, it is 2 years. For an older vehicle, it is every year. We have dedicated tracks where we do it. But in one of our offices in Nashik, We have what is called as inspection and certification center. This is the money has come from MORTH, and it is manned by a service provider who has supplied all the equipment, the decibel meter, the brake, roller brake testing machine, and then the pollution control testing machine, the wheel sleep out, the caster camber measuring machine. All those things are in place now. It is a it is just like an automobile industry assembly line. So more or less, and this centers would be replicated very soon. So that is a place where these things would be checked annually at least. Regarding on-road enforcement, there is no other structure. Whatever sampling that we do, that's the only thing. No, actually, I understand from a manufacturer point of view, from a person who is suppose manufacturing the firefighting machines or SLDs, or he was supplier of some RFID kind of thing. Usko to jaldi rehti hai. Lekin you have to. There's a huge transport lobby. You who are your customers who are into auto deepers. Aapko maloom hai na? Kitna din se chal raha hai? Nahi aa raha hai. Lekin abhi bhi. Because it adds to the cost heavily. So, you know, there are so many things. That is a lobby which prevails a lot on everything. Otherwise, the lowermost part, that is the district authority, has to implement whatever comes. So it is primarily the, aapko malum nahi hai shayad, we are now implementing the safe axle weights. Meaning, earlier there was some weight described. Now they have increased the weights. So, you know, there are so many things happening. Okay? Thank you so much. Thank you.